How AI search engines work. My name is Sam. This is part of our AI SEO series. And in this video, we're going to look at how AI models generate responses and what influences those results. We'll go over how AI models generate results, what influences those results, and then a couple of challenges and limitations to current AI models. So first, how AI models generate results. We'll break this down into five steps. One is training on large data sets. The second is tokenization. The third is context understanding. The fourth is the prediction of the next token. And finally, fine tuning. So first, training on large data sets. So AI models are trained on tons of data from books, articles, websites, other publicly available sources. We just feed it a bunch of data. And then during training, the model learns patterns, grammar, semantics, context, and then even some factual information. So we give it a bunch of information, and then it needs to start to understand it and break that down. That process is called tokenization. So when a user inputs a query or a search term or a question, the text is broken down into smaller units called tokens. That might be a word or a part of a word or an individual character. The model processes these tokens to understand the input, and it helps it to put it in context then to other tokens and other input and all the data that it's been trained on. So that leads us to context understanding. So AI models analyze the input contextually. They consider the word order, syntax, the semantic meaning, the words that are around it, what came previously in the conversation. And then it uses contextual embeddings like those produced by transformers to help the model understand nuanced meanings. And contextual embeddings is basically just the context that that word is in. And we'll break this out here quickly. So imagine you have a magic robot that reads books, and it doesn't even need to be a magic robot. There are robots that can read books. But so this robot's reading books, and when it sees a word, it doesn't just remember that word by itself, but it also takes into context all of the words around it. This helps the robot figure out what the word really means. For example, if the robot sees bat in the following two sentences, it knows the difference. So the bat flew in the dark, it knows you're talking about the animal. I hit the ball with the bat, and knows you're talking about the stick used in baseball. The robot uses a super smart tool called a transformer to understand how the words connect and make sense together like pieces of a puzzle so that it doesn't get confused and it can give you better answers. Next step here is in how AI models generate results is the prediction of the next token. So the core mechanism that these the core mechanism of these models is to predict the next token in the series of words. So the next word or the subword based on the sequence of tokens already provided. So it takes everything that it's already created, and then it looks at, okay, given what we know here, what's the next most likely or best token to continue that sentence? And that process continues iteratively until the response is complete. And then finally, there's fine tuning. So many AI models then can be fine tuned for specific tasks, whether that's customer support, coding, legal advice, to enhance accuracy in those specific areas. So that's a high level overview of how AI models generate results. Now we're going to look at what can influence those results. So there's eight steps here: input quality, training data, model size and architecture, temperature and sampling parameters, biases and training data, external tools and plugins, fine tuning and customization, and finally, user feedback and iteration. And we'll quickly run through these eight. So first is input quality. And again, we're looking at what influences the results that we're getting back from an AI model. What are we giving it? So clear and detailed questions or prompts are going to give you a better and more accurate response. If you are ambiguous or vague, you're going to get less precise answers. That intuitively makes sense. Number two is the training data is going to influence the results. So the quality, the diversity, the recency of training data is going to significantly influence the model's knowledge and accuracy. If models are trained on old data, outdated data, they might lack awareness of recent events or technologies. This is one of the, I'll say, bugaboos of current AI, is like you spend all this time and money and resource into training it, and that takes time. But if that's you're a year out, and anything that's happened in the past year, not only like from a news world culture context perspective, but also just from like an advancements in technology, it's not going to have any of that new data. It's going to be working off of what it was trained on. What influenced results number three, the model size and architecture. So larger models with more parameters can process and understand complex inputs better, but they also take more computational resources. So obviously the more data that we give it, the more context it will have. So it should provide better answers, but that's more data, it's more resource to produce that and to make it all happen. Number four, temperature and sampling parameters. Parameters like temperature, which would be the control of randomness in responses. So a lower temperature is going to give you a more deterministic focused answer, where a higher temperature is going to allow more variability and creativity in your responses. And then sampling parameters, so top K or nucleus sampling, that will determine how the model selects the next token. Breaking that out quickly. So imagine the AI is picking the next word in a story, and it can be like a game where lots of cards to choose from. So you have your current sentence, and then you have five choices of, hey, here could be the next word. Top K means the AI only looks at the top number of best cards, so the top five most likely words, and picks one of those top five. Where nucleus sampling is like saying, only look at the cards that together make the best group to continue the story. These are just different rules that the AI can use to choose words that would make sense, instead of just picking any random word from the pile. But how it was trained and what sampling parameters are used is going to impact the results that were given. Number five, biases in training data. So models can inadvertently have biases that are present within the data that they were trained on. And so, you know, if you have bad data that you're being trained on, that's going to be reflected in the results. That again makes sense and goes back to the better data set that we have, the more data that we have, assuming it's good data, the better your responses are going to be. Number six would be external tools and plugins. So with external tools, web searches, databases, plugins, you're giving more information to the AI model, and that can influence the results. In the example of a web search, if it's able to search the web and process more recent news stories, you could have more accurate and up-to-date responses. Number seven, fine-tuning and customization. So models can be fine-tuned or custom-trained. We mentioned this earlier, but you could have legal or medical or engineering-specific applications or tuning that would provide more domain-specific and relevant outputs to those areas. And finally, user feedback and iteration. So models are typically conversational and interacting with the model iteratively, asking follow-up questions is going to improve the quality of your results and your responses. Finally here, we're going to look at a couple challenges and limitations to AI models and the current state of things. So one, there's hallucinations. That's when AI models make up stuff. So they generate plausible sounding information, but it's actually incorrect or nonsensical. There's contextual limits. So sometimes if you give it a lot of information, or if you have a longer conversation, they can start to get disjointed and it could lose track of earlier context. And then there's ethical considerations. So AI can inadvertently propagate misinformation or harmful stereotypes. So that needs to be monitored and considered, both from people designing them, but also as you're getting information back from AI. It's generally good to verify what you're getting back at this point in time. All right, that's going to finish up our How AI Models Work and Generate Results series. Again, this was a high-level overview. It's obviously much, much, much more technical than this, but this should give some understanding for how it works and can help us think through then from a search perspective, things to be considering, and we'll dive more into that in upcoming videos. If you have questions or comments, please leave them in the comment section, and then stay tuned for more. You can find the whole series at sambretzman.com. Thank you for watching. I hope you have a great day.